sought information for a living. That is to say that ever since he returned from Korea, after having served with the armed forces, he had been working as a private investigator in Montreal. William Hamilton, a rich industrialist, had gotten in touch with him regarding a simple vandalism issue. Nothing to write home about. Not worth hiring a private eye either, just so he can drive for hours on rough roads. But that's how it had always been. The client pays, Carl gets it done. They had set up to meet at the general store, his client's business. Well, actually, the entire village had William Hamilton's name written all over it. When the roads were bad, muddy, or snowed in, it was customary around these parts to close them off. But it was also customary to ignore those signs entirely and drive there anyway. Hamilton never mentioned a road-blocking barrier. Why was it needed here in the back of beyond? That would, however, be a mystery for another day. Carl had waited long enough for someone to come and raise it. Still not a soul in sight. There was no point in waiting any longer. Carl had to figure this one out by himself. Hamilton is waiting for Carl in the general store. It was time for him to get down to business. William Hamilton enjoyed a lavish country house built in the very heart of the northern forests, not too far from here. The local populace was divided when it came to the affluent man. Some saw a wealthy philanthropist dedicated to improving the region's economy. Others an aging Englishman who would do anything to further his fortunes. And those ones hated him enough to go on about scheming against him. Hamilton had recently acquired a few local businesses. But the last straw was the reopening of a mine, which gave rise to a wave of protests and threats from the Cree people. Given these circumstances, Carl reckoned that a good number of people must be feeling compelled to oppose Hamilton in one way or another. So far, only the industrialist's house had been a target, but soon enough, Carl thought, the target would become the man himself. To get out of there. The cold and the pain required urgent care. driver had taken off. It was still best to check it out and leave nothing to chance. Carl needed help. It was a small, locked box engraved with the letters WH. Carl thought about taking it. Nothing was to be left to chance. This deep in the country, his last hope was to find an abandoned garage or a farm by the roadside. His life depended on it. Scratches did not stop Carl. His mother would be so proud. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. Carl, like many of his contemporaries, felt like he had more trouble breathing when he wasn't smoking. Cigarette was his own personal breathing assistant. set out on a few acres of untouched forest, bellowing caribou, everlasting snow, and undefiled lakes. The Manistan region was no tourist hub. It was said to have been populated for millennia by Cree people, and ever since the industrial era, by the metal mining industry. The truck was running on fumes. Good thing that the general store was close by. Surrender their divine nectar so easily. In all likelihood, they had to be switched on from inside the store. Something fell to the bottom of the box. Carl had no trouble recognizing his employer. He had been killed. There was no need to be a detective to figure that out. But only a detective could have noticed that the killer had to have been very close. That the fatal blow had been given before the victim even realized. What could be inside that envelope? Carl was taken aback. He knew this address. It was said to be the address of the P.O. box for the Canadian Secret Service. Jumping from that height was akin to tempting death. Perhaps that man on the snowmobile had seen enough of this world already. The note explained that the garage and the store couldn't be supplied with electricity at the same time. An explosion suddenly occurred outside. Carl was used to strange phenomena, but a chunk of ice like this, as if an iceberg came out of the ground, that was a first. Carl, ever diligent in his work, always carried his log on him, in which he scribbled down thoughts and leads alike during the course of his investigations. Hate was in the air. Seems like some villagers barely tolerated each other. Mm-hmm. milkman had to drive by every week to fill the bottles. The fresh milk indicated a recent visit. The note explained that the garage and the store couldn't be supplied with electricity at the same time. A murder weapon. What was that doing there, Carl wondered. Hamilton must have been determined to keep some information secret to post this key. Shame he got unlucky. Everything made sense now. Poor Hamilton's denunciation was interrupted, and he figured it would be best to lock everything up and send the key to his correspondent, who would receive the box later on. Clever, but not enough. That's what happens to ordinary people playing spy. The pumps wouldn't surrender their divine nectar so easily. In all likelihood, they had to be switched on from inside the store. Carl knew that Gilles Lachance was in charge of the general store. That made him one of Hamilton's employees. A very angry employee, as Carl could plainly see. According to that log, it seemed like the whole village owed some money to the general store. Carl was far more interested in the bunch of nearby addresses he had just gotten his hands on, though. The Polaroid, Carl's long-standing and faithful ally, had seen a share of husbands caught red-handed cheating. There's always something out there waiting to be snapped away. A radiator without power is as good as a wood stove without logs. The pumps wouldn't surrender their divine nectar so easily. In all likelihood, they had to be switched on from inside the store. It was so cold. Already Carl did not feel his toes anymore. Knew straight away where to find the infuriated Gilles Lachance. Any good investigation would have to start there. Carl felt that the store and its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out. Cold seemed to be more brutal here than anywhere else. It seeped into bones and into every breath to get to the heart until it stopped. Carl needed to be dressed in warm clothes to survive.
Yeah, man.
Sometimes, and especially around here, people are so possessive with their land as a dog is with hydrants. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. Roswell, Atamipec, same story. Large deserts conducive to extravagant follies. Weird stuff. Kind of a crossing between a colander and a hairdryer. What was it for? To play telepath? To protect against nuclear waves? Carl hadn't lived up to his good finder reputation. He still hadn't found any of the wealth contained in Lamotte's lands. By following the plan, Carl was led to believe that the snowmobile's parts had to be scattered about in the vicinity. The very first steps of man on the moon were made more than a year ago. The event had surely captivated the mechanic's mind for him to still keep this around. The man seemed petrified in ice. What Carl saw terrified him, and he didn't know if it was the fear or the cold that was responsible for his hair standing on end all over his body. The poor man, before being frozen solid, seemed to be defending the entrance to his cabin. But from what? something very important must have been in there for the man to take such time and effort to hide it. But Carl didn't know how to reach it. Carl deducted this was a map of the area. Were those pins pointing to places of interest? Milk was sorted by color, from the whitest to the greenest, or in other words, from the freshest to the sourest. Well, this truck's not going anywhere. Where were the amputated parts? Carl grinned as he pictured a Frankenstein-esque car lying around somewhere made of parts from a dozen different vehicles. What good was a motorless car? The mechanic sure had an odd way to go about repairing things. Weird stuff. Kind of a crossing between a colander and a hairdryer. What was it for? To play telepath? To protect against nuclear waves? Carl deducted this was a map of the area. Were those pins pointing to places of interest? If some daring person could manage to get their hands on the missing parts, Carl was willing to bet that the craft would have taken flight. The man has a passion for intergalactic things. Back then, people were obviously scared of the Russian atomic bomb, but an invasion by extraterrestrials was a legit fear as well. Seems like the mechanic had made his choice. To all appearances, Carl concluded, the owner of the place had moved more essentials from his house inside the garage. Peculiar man indeed. The shape of this machine, almost straight out of Star Trek, was out of the ordinary to say the least. It felt like this thing could fly up into space at any moment. It was an indisputable fact that machines like this entailed a level of intellectual finesse that Carl was lacking. Carol never thought he would be dancing with the wolves. Had no idea how to interpret a message like that. On the surface, it seemed like he had one half too many of this puzzle, enough to know he shouldn't take this testimony as gospel. The entire thing, being some punishment for a murder committed by Hamilton, seemed like an outlandish theory. Carl was doubtful. Bit of gas, a new spark plug, and a key, and this thing would run perfectly. All he needed to do now was to find all that. dots of metal everywhere. Was Carl out of touch with current home improvement trends? Or perhaps this was meant to protect against residual radiation? Gamma rays? Carl still wasn't done with the mechanics place.
Oh, no, better.
The crowbar was stuck under the lift. Notwithstanding Carl's imposing stature, car lifting wasn't part of his skill set yet. At long last, the crowbar was within Carl's grasp. Surely it would come in handy at some point. Surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out. Still wasn't done with the mechanic's place. Large antenna in the middle of the path, undoubtedly ideal in attempting to communicate with little green men, was quite awkwardly placed. There had to be a lever to control it, maybe behind it. Carl would have to figure out how to reach it. The electric terminals appeared to be linked together, but for what purpose? Carl rejoiced at the unexpected source of heat, but not as much as his freezing hands. So that's where the generator key was hiding. All that was left was to use it. So big an effort for an oh-so-tiny piece of metal. Carl still wasn't done with the mechanics place.
Je m'attendais pas à ce qu'un étrange orthontiste par ici. M'a dire, je prends plus de chance depuis que ça rôde dans ce bout-là. J'ai ma carabine au bout du doigt, et puis bang, 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 si ça s'approche. Si tu veux du linge chaud, parce que t'es habillé comme un gars de la ville, je dirais pas non à une bonne bouteille de caribou. Puis tu pigeras ce que tu voudras parmi mes guenilles. Hé, hey, la Corriveau, bannette. Ça te passe l'envie de te marier, la Corriveau? À Tuette ou ses maris, squeak, les uns après les autres. Pas de pitié dans le mariage. Tu sens des pieds. mon beau bonnet du beau temps. Tu m'as séduit parce que je me disais bon, le monde dormait.
Empty-handed. A wintry atmosphere surrounded the house. The soundlessness of the area suggested it was empty. Money in a jar. What a shame. Carl would have loved cookies. The key, which seemed to be meant for a padlock, bore an inscription reading Klutze et Fils. A company name. Better keep an eye open. Businesses weren't exactly numerous around these parts. A window left open in that weather? Perhaps something had to be watched. Fresh. That meant the car sunk down just a little while ago. Now where the hell could the passengers possibly have gone? Someone had been playing with a crossbow here. A very dangerous game. A bolt could hit someone's tire, or their eye. It could even kill someone if the aim was right. There was only void where the road should be. Carl hated dead ends. He felt trapped. It was as if the road had drowned in the lake. He would have to find help by another route. Someone must have dropped this in a hurry, but whoever did was heading into the woods. Carl's tracking instincts were quickly kicking in. Suddenly shivering. He was going back to the realm of visions. Carl had no issue recognizing the spirit-like figures, but he couldn't figure out what they wanted from him. The phantom, freed of reality's shackles, vanished in the forest. Earlier, Carl had witnessed a tragedy that befell it. The further Carl moved away from the ice bore, the more his senses came back to him. A pay stub for some undoubtedly harsh lumberjack work. Alexandre Blais felled trees and chopped woods for Cloutier et Fils. Little Martin Blais with his uncle Pierre. There was a deep sense of bonding and pride coming out of the picture. Carl felt sorry for the man. No one deserved such a cruel fate. When finding a boot, one wonders what became of the foot. Carl's big fingers prevented him from reaching the key. Fresh. That meant the car sunk down just a little while ago. Now where the hell could the passengers possibly have gone? Someone had been playing with a crossbow here. A very dangerous game. A bolt could hit someone's tire or their eye. It could even kill someone if the aim was right. Only void where the road should be. Carl hated dead ends. He felt trapped. It was as if the road had drowned in the lake. He would have to find help by another route. Suddenly shivering. He was going back to the realm of visions. Carl had no issue recognizing the spirit-like figures, but he couldn't figure out what they wanted from him. The phantom, freed of reality's shackles, vanished in the forest. Earlier, Carl had witnessed a tragedy that befell it. The further Carl moved away from the ice block, the more his senses came back to him. Thank you. Welcome to Ali Baba's Cave, Lumberjack Edition. Surely Carl would find something worth his time in here. Too shabby. Carl felt he needed to protect himself. It was a typical shack, just like the ones you hear about in Quebecois legends. Local lumberjacks used it to rest and twice a day heat up their pea soup. Thank you. leftover food, the clothes, the general warmth of the place, no evidence of escape. Carl was sure of it. People were here not long ago, and they expected to come back. Crossbow bolts had the same origin. Carl was sure of it. Who was it? And more importantly, what was being hunted like this? Without a single window to brighten things up, the inside of the cabin was almost pitch black. Beware of close encounters of me and furniture. Everything was set up for a well-deserved snack. It seemed like the place hadn't been empty for long, but without knowing exactly why, Carl had to feel... no one was coming back anytime soon. That the store and its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out. Finding a locked door in the country is not that big of a deal. Carl knew a key had to be hidden nearby. In spite of Dr. Beaupré's goodwill, the place didn't look much like a physician's office. It could easily be mistaken for a sewing shop. There should be a law forbidding doctors from falling sick. For the one-eyed, or for other vision problems, the eye patch was the way to go. Carl got the trembles as he imagined the excruciating pain that kind of scalpel could no doubt inflict. Within these miserable walls, patients probably felt more like in a slaughterhouse than in a doctor's office. A communist manifesto. Only a few years ago, this type of allegiance meant prison time. And even at present, the Western world was very wary of the Soviet threat. Why would the doctor own such a book? The injured could be recognized by the large stains of red. An informal nickname given to Merbroman, smudged all over their injuries. Someone had lost a few liters of blood here. Carl's first thought had been a lumber accident, someone's hand cut by a saw, or a hunting accident. In any case, whoever had lost all this blood couldn't have gone far. Perhaps they were already dead. Great care had to be taken searching this place full of oddities. Everything was important. The decor itself told a story. Before. The garden shed? Carl couldn't reach it with his arm alone, but he had more than a few tricks up his sleeve to pick it up. couldn't surrender their divine nectar so easily. In all likelihood, they had to be switched on from inside the store. And its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out. Carl still wasn't done with the mechanic's place. Mm-hmm. mechanic was still frozen, and Carl had everything he needed, so he felt ready to leave. That the store and its surroundings still held their secrets, and he didn't like to miss out.
Thank you.
Sometimes, and especially around here, people are so possessive with their land as a dog is with hydrants. That it was mission accomplished with the wicked nectar in his hands.
Cherche, on trouve. Parce que je t'aime bien, Astor, je vais te dire quelque chose. Tu fais bien de prendre ma pénisse. Parce que par là-bas, tu vas rencontrer le vrai froid. Un froid qui glace comme t'en as jamais connu dans ta vie. C'est encore beau. Tout ce qui est vieilli est bien meilleur.
The old man's cabin had been very generous to me. I couldn't have asked for more. Luckily, he had the coat to protect him from the biting cold. Seems like the elements showed mercy to those nice and solid-looking planks. Another instance of this magic ice. What was this one doing, lying on the ground, so afraid? The plot thickened like water into ice. He had been running in fear from something creeping towards him, against which he couldn't do anything, only to end up like this, petrified and cold. It seemed as though Regin had been ready to take up arms and slay people like Hamilton. Could he have committed murder for his cause? Who could have gotten killed in front of his very eyes? ice seemed to take over this place like mold. That wall wasn't there earlier. How was he going to get out of here? The ice, oddly, did not budge despite the powerful fiery blast. Something was definitely rotten in this place. Carl suddenly felt observed. He was worried about a presence around him. No stone can withstand the force of dynamite. Thank you. Carl felt a chill down his spine and had a terrifying realization. If Hamilton was dead, then who was going to pay him? Was beginning to know the store and its surroundings like the back of his hand. The Seeker had saw it.
Thank you.
another phantom disappeared in the wilderness. Carl had seen what happened to it, too. Numbness was giving way to awareness. The vision was wavering. Be the worst parking job ever. Who was Carl to judge, though? It may be customary to park like that around these parts, or not. The punishing cold rendered the door frozen tight. Carl saw no way to open it.
I'm
becoming increasingly convinced that this was not normal hunting. The game that was being tracked was fearsome, so much so that the hunter didn't dare approach it. Shit. What could it be? The air was freezing, right down to the bone. The otherworldly ice had struck again. The woman's hopes and dreams were frozen in eternity. Something was hidden under the stairs. The man grabbed his rifle. Carl felt a sense of dread in him. Perhaps their spousal relationship had been cooling down lately. It seemed like secrecy was commonplace in this house. The vision's veil was lifted, and he was back to reality. A reality in which Giselle, Jill's loving spouse, was motionless, frozen in ice. Carl had seen that kind of safe before, with its double-layered security system blending letters and numbers. Its code couldn't be broken by the common burglar. Ah, moving. What a pleasant activity. Of course, you'll find the record player only to find the records weeks later in some random box. The general store, along with several more infrastructures in the area, had been acquired by wealthy industrialist William J. Hamilton. Perhaps the village should be rechristened Hamiltown. Mess. Clearly, there was some major revamping work underway here. The place looked barely habitable. Looks like the holes in that puzzle are there to stay. Shiver ran down Carl's spine as he glanced over another body trapped in ice. Indeed, the scene was quite chilling. Carl felt familiar shivers going down his spine, and he was back to the realm of vision. To all appearances, this was a hunting log. Better yet, a war diary. What could these engraved numbers mean? A fresh path suddenly appeared before Carl. Vision slowly faded away, like an icicle melting in the palm of your hand. Carl, back in the real world, now knew who the icebound man was. Gilles Lachance, the general store's manager himself. third phantom gently faded away. Carl noticed that as the cursed villagers finally left reality, he could feel a sense of unburdening exuding from them in an almost intimate way. The last phantom, lost in solitude up until now, joined the others in the forest's darkness, free at last to enjoy an eternal, well-deserved slumber. Carl was only beginning to understand the horror which had struck his village. He understood that the dead were piling up and that he couldn't help them by himself. The road was clear for him. He needed to push further north and fast to find help. For the one-eyed, or for other vision problems, the eye patch was the way to go. There was no doubt that the doctor and Hamilton knew each other very well. The good doctor, flanked by his beautiful spouse. Pure happiness, captured on cardstock. Carl recognized this woman's soulful eyes. was a Dr. Beaupré who had hit him head-on at the village border. Nobody kills a rich patient to start a revolution. It didn't make any sense. He had to dig deeper still to understand. Luckily, that was Carl Faubert's specialty. Felt like he knew the doctor now. His belongings had spoken lengths about him. But what Carl had heard worried him. Another diary. Carl felt like someone was trying to communicate with him. Or was it simply the result of happenstance? Right until that point, Carl had believed that the object of this crossbow hunting had been a ravenous wolf who was terrorizing the village. But as he noticed the height at which the bolts had been fired, he concluded that the beast had to have been as tall as a man on his feet, not unlike a gorilla. The thought was chilling. Carl had found what he was looking for. He needed to get back on the road. Carl reckoned that the place was still inhabited less than 24 hours ago. His detective sense tingled, revealing to him, or was it the strong smell of wilderness in the air, that there were most likely two men, two blankets. There were doubtless two people here, Carl reckoned. The jacket was still soaking wet. The poor man had, surely unwillingly, had a taste of the pond's water not too long ago. According to the pay stub, that poor man was Alexandre Blais. The door was unlocked. Carl felt kind of disappointed that he wouldn't have to solve the mystery of that padlock. Seems like the elements showed mercy to those nice and solid-looking planks. The door had been busted down violently, and a burnt smell filled the air. Half of the cabin had been consumed by flames. Carl surveyed the chaotic scene, noticing that someone appeared to have intended to use the furniture as bonfire fuel. Carl had no idea how such a mess could have occurred, but he knew it didn't bode well. This hunt was never ending. Carl hoped that the hunter had finally triumphed over the beast. Seems like this place was long deserted. Two more victims of this ice plague. Carl felt a chill down his spine. What if he was next? Carl felt the strong pull of a vision overcome him. Like a simple hunting accident. There was Hamilton. Carl recognized him. A major hunting accident. The doctor examined the young woman. death couldn't be overturned. She was dead. It was not the type of body you buried in a big ceremony in the village graveyard. It had to be hidden. No one could know about this. The best way to do that was to have a simple-minded man bury the poor girl, Lamotte, the mechanic. Denied the unfair death of the young woman, but Hamilton had him in his grips. Hamilton knew all of the poet's secrets and wouldn't hesitate to reveal them. I know all about your crimes, you little communist. You know mine. What a sordid affair. Understood the ins and outs of the affair. A woman had been killed in an unfair accident, and a young warrior had damned himself to avenge her. But Hamilton, the one responsible, had already been killed, and so the beast could not quench his thirst for vengeance. And now, recklessly, Carl had pulled the bolt from the beast's heart. A beast who was but a young free man lost without his fiancée, and who had, out of hatred, become Wendigo. Thank you. house and sheltered him. But for how long? Disappeared, so did Purity. I would defend Purity against the winds, the tides, against ice and blizzard. Could it be that all this was but a story of justice and vengeance? The soulful doctor, avenging his fiancée's unjust death by avenging this young woman as though she was his lover. Are these passionate feelings not precisely the kind of feelings that could cause a storm, petrify people deep inside, create monsters?
Un survivant ! On a trouvé un survivant !